sorry. I gotta count carefully.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3.
Thank you.
How fast do you want to get for 16 minutes?
Ready and go. bum, 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 bum.
one more from this book.
One, two, three.
Thank you.
stick to measure. I don't know what happened. Vicky Wenceslas.
Yep.
Da 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 da. 1 and 2 and ready go.
Everybody, I've had to catch myself so many times not saying good morning. Everyone, welcome to Wellspring. Welcome to our Christmas Eve service. We are so thankful that you are here tonight. You get together as family, and what better way to sit and to sing and to listen to the gospel than with your family, with your kids? It's going to be loud. It's going to be crazy. It's okay. Let's all stand together and sing. Well, we have a special treat for you tonight. We have some kids in the crowd that would like to come sing for you, and you guys can take a seat while they're doing that. So kids, come on up. Also, would you give the string players a hand before service? That was awesome. So they're going to do a clapping part, and if you guys would like to follow along, it's pretty catchy, so you guys can do it. Oh, come all ye full, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. One, two, three. Oh, come on, faithful. Oh, come on, you faithful. Come, let us adore him. Oh, sing choirs of angels, sing in exaltation. Oh, sing all ye citizens of heaven above. Oh, glory to God, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. One, two, three. Oh, come on. Oh, come on, ye faithful. Come, let us adore him. Oh, sing hallelujah. He alone is worthy. Oh, sing hallelujah. He alone is worthy. Oh yes, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to thee be all glory given. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. One, two, three, four. Oh, come on. Let us adore him. Oh, sing hallelujah. He alone is worthy. Oh, sing hallelujah. He Yeah, do it like you want. All right, next up, we are going to have our candle lighting. So if Jack and Kayla Fraser and their kids could come up.
Hey, guys. Thanks so much for being here. We're transitioning now. I know that was super exciting. Great job, guys. They've been practicing like every week for 4 weeks now. So awesome job. Hey, so this is, those of you that may not know, this is the kind of the culmination of the season of Advent. Advent is the season leading up to Christmas. So we've been preparing for this night for several weeks. And one of the ways that we like to celebrate Advent here at Wellspring is to just challenge our congregation to give generously to missional works in St. Joseph that are making a difference in people's lives. And so as you guys came in tonight, you see some displays in the back there for some local ministries that we like to support. So if there's something back there that you'd be interested in helping just with their finances for the next year, we'd love to support them. One of those that was started by a lady here at Wellspring, Sisters of Solace, Stacy Kearns, was one of the 20 who count in St. Joe in the paper today. So good job, Stacy. And we've also been lighting our Advent candles behind us. Each one of those candles has a theme. Each week we've been taking a look at the themes of hope, joy, love, and peace the last 4 weeks. And tonight we're culminating with the Christ candle. And each week we've had a family that has come and kind of shared a little bit about what that theme has meant in their life in the past year. Tonight we've got a special time because Jack and Kayla, who live in a home that we own here in the neighborhood right up the street called the Guest House, they do ministry to local neighborhood kids. They're going to come and share with some of their friends a little bit about what the light of Christ means to them. So come on up, guys.
Thank you. Hey, guys. We're really happy to be here on Christmas Eve. My name is Jack Fraser. This is my wife, Kayla, and this is our friend, Lena. She lives in the neighborhood. She's over, like, every day, it seems like, which is a good thing. And, yeah, we were supposed to have a couple more kids, but they were out of town. But, you know, that's how it goes sometimes. So that was all I was supposed to do, right? Yes. Passing it out.
Christmas Eve marks the last time this year that we will light the Advent candles. For 4 weeks, we have lit the candles and reflected on hope, peace, joy, and love. These are a few of the things Christ brought us as gifts at Christmas time, and our lives are forever changed because of him.
So a question we often ask at Wellspring is, how are you sensing God work in you and those around you? And that's kind of a loaded question. I feel like I could talk about that all night, just because both Kayla's job and my job overlap with a ton of ministries here at Wellspring, so we get to see God working in a ton of different people of all different age ranges. We get to hang out with kids and people in the neighborhood and their families all the time, obviously. We go to College Young Life. That happens here Thursday nights, and that's awesome just to see college kids surrendering their lives and their big choices to Christ, where they're going to work, what they're going to spend their money on. I hang out with Kenny all the time, and he's always talking about his high schoolers, how they're just always relying on Christ through their mental health struggles, diving into their childhood upbringing and family history. And I also just get to connect with a ton of people in the community that they just choose to live their life for Christ. They foster, adopt. They're building gyms, garages, fixing up rental houses, all so that they can love people better. That's really the only reason. Why else would they sacrifice so much time and money? So we see a lot that goes on in the community, and I just want to take this time just to say good job and thank you all. It's really inspiring. We don't have to do things for God. We're his children, holy, blameless, and above reproach, Colossians says. But we still have to allow him to work through us. And, you know, he doesn't force us to do anything, so we can still say no to those things. But a lot of you guys are saying yes. And, yeah, we just see Christ through you guys. So thank you so much. We're super grateful for the positions we have and the time that we get to spend with everybody. So I'll just close with this before I hand off the mic again. Before moving to St. Joe, I lived a lot of my life believing that I wasn't good enough, that I wasn't important, that God couldn't use me. But just seeing everyone's stories here at Wellspring has shifted my perspective. I know God believes in me because he's going to help me along the way. So after service, we're about to head home to be with family. And I just want to remind us all that Jesus left his home so that he could come and get us. That was probably a sacrifice to leave perfect heaven, but he did it because he loved us. He is the perfect example of surrender. So thank you all for being amazing examples of surrender as well, really. It's just helped us as a young married couple. And just keep being a great example of Christ. Thank you, guys.
So tonight we'll light the Christ candle.
So as we look at all five candles glowing, we remember that Christ is the light that has shone into the darkness of the world. John 1, 4 through 5 says this about Christ. Everything was created through him. Nothing, not one thing, came into being without him. What came into existence was life, and the life was light to live by. The life light blazed out of the darkness. The darkness couldn't put it out.
We hope your own heart knows this light and can feel it even more strongly tonight as we worship. Today is a day to celebrate. Because of the first Christmas, we can walk in light, know the truth, and have the hope of eternal life.
Cool. Let's pray, and then we can get back to some songs. Thank you, God. Thank you for tonight as we sit here, surrounded by our family and by the joy of the season. I just pray that we would let our hearts feel the warmth of your light in our lives. Thank you for the hope, joy, peace, and love you brought us. And thank you for the gift of Jesus. Help us to celebrate a God who became Emmanuel, God with us, today and always. Amen.
Would you stand with us?
Light of the world, treasure of heaven, brilliant like the stars in the wintry sky. Joy of the Father, reach through the darkness, shine across the earth. Send the shadows to fly. Light up the world from the beginning. The tragedies of time were no match for your love. From great heights of glory, you saw my story. God, you entered in and became one of us. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah for the things he has done. Come and adore him, bow down before him, sing hallelujah to the light of the world.
Light up the world, crowned in a manger, born for the cross. Suffer to save the high king of heaven, death in the poorer. We are the rich by the price that he paid. Sing hallelujah.
crowds he will lead us straight into glory, and there he shall reign
Hallelujah. worship this one. I know you came to rescue me.
I know you came to rescue me. This baby boy would grow to be a man and one day die for me and you.
Praise God.
My sins would drive the nails in you. That rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath you drew was hallelujah.
Of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all we praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh. His name forever. His power and glory evermore proclaim.
Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for tonight. We're so thankful that you, the God of the universe, chose to be with us. You chose to be Emmanuel and come from your throne where you deserve to sit and to come below us, where you didn't deserve to be. And then not only that, that choice led you to a cross where you chose to die for us. And we're here today so thankful for those decisions that you made. God, may we focus our hearts on you. And may we have joy that is so great. May we have peace because you are peace. You are great and you are good, and you're holy, in your precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. You can be seated.
All right, kids, we're going to get through this together, okay? These guys are used to being dismissed. Not tonight. Anybody else struggle with the wardrobe choice tonight? You're like looking at the closet, you're looking at the temperature, you're like, do I wear short sleeves and expose the world to my pasty white arms? Do I wear shorts? I don't know what to do. So we're all in here in our long sleeves. It's been a peculiar year for sure. When the angel appeared to the shepherds on a hill outside of Bethlehem, he told them that they would find a Savior wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And so the shepherds hurried off to go and see if it was true. And sure enough, everything was just as the angel had said. Luke 2, 17 and 18 tells us what happened next. It says that when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. I love that word, wonder. And I love this definition that I came across for wonder this week. It's better than I could have imagined. It said that wonder is this: a feeling of surprise mingled with admiration caused by something beautiful, unexpected, unfamiliar, or inexplicable. Man, that's good. And I'm sure the shepherds were thinking, could it be? It sounds too good to be true. This Messiah, the Savior that they've been waiting for thousands of years, was finally here, born in a cave to a young, unknown couple. I mean, you couldn't make this stuff up. As I've shared with you guys before, I have really vivid memories of my first Christmas Eve service after I became a follower of Christ. I surrendered my life to Jesus on December 30th of 1985 at a Young Life camp in Colorado. So I had just missed Christmas. And so I had to wait almost another year to experience my first Christmas Eve service. So I was 16 at that time. So the next year, Christmas Eve, I was 17. And it was December 24th, 1986. My mom and I drove downtown to Kansas City. We lived in Liberty. We went to this church down in Westport I've been going to with one of my friends, my high school friends, called Broadway Baptist Church. It was the first time that my mom and I had ever been to church together on any occasion. And I remember so much of that night. It was a midnight service, so that was kind of unique. Imagine keeping the kids up that late. So it was midnight, and this church was kind of shaped in a half semicircle. The balcony we sat on the left side of the balcony. I still remember where we were. And I remember they had like blue lights shining up on the wall. I remember the candles. And I remember just this peace that just enveloped me that whole evening. And I don't remember anything that was said or anything that was sung that night. I just remember that I was caught up in the wonder of the story. The Savior that I'd come to worship that night, I was a part of that story now. My life had intertwined with Jesus. He had come to save the world from sin, and I, Bob Miller, was one of the people that he had come to rescue and call his own. And it was the first time that Christmas had ever really meant anything to me. And the memory of that night is burned into my heart and mind because I knew Christmas would never be the same again. A shift had taken place in my soul from self-centered to God and others-centered, from someone who just consumed Christmas to someone who worshiped at Christmas. And my guess is that there were many who heard what the shepherd shared in the days and weeks to come after that event that we started with this evening. Many people who probably Many people who wondered at the news, but didn't really follow Jesus. I know that's true because 30 years later, when Jesus arrives on the scene and begins his ministry, and Scripture tells us that he's teaching and preaching and healing and going from town to town throughout Israel. It's said that the crowds were amazed at the things that he said and did. But very few actually followed him. And that was maybe never more evident than when he returned to his hometown of Nazareth. His first time back since he'd been out beginning his ministry, he goes back to the home synagogue that he'd grown up in, surrounded by the people that he'd known by name his whole life. Scripture tells us that he takes the scroll of Isaiah and he begins to read a prophecy really about himself, how he was the fulfillment of the scripture, the messianic scripture. And after teaching, this is the reaction that his hometown people had. In Luke 4:22, it says this: "All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. 'Isn't this Joseph's son?' they asked." They were amazed and filled with wonder, right? Until just a few moments later, because Jesus went on to teach a little bit more and turn the heat up just a bit. And just a few minutes later in verse 29, we see this. It says, "They got up, drove him out of town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff." I don't start getting any ideas, all right? Guys, reactions to Jesus, if you kind of look at the Gospels, could be lumped into kind of three areas. People either kind of looked at him with wonder and amazement, or they were kind of just indifferent. Not many people were really that indifferent. Or they were kind of filled with disdain for Christ. And so which type of person will we be? I wonder. Will we be humble? Jesus, as we all know, came to this earth in the most humble way that somebody could come, just like all of us do. Born to a teenage mother, young parents of absolutely no social standing in a cave. Are we willing to serve him in whatever capacity he calls us to do whatever with whomever he plans for us? Will we be humble? I wonder. Will we be dependent? Jesus, again, grew up like any other child, completely dependent on a mother and a father for care, protection, and provision. And then when he transitioned into adulthood, he threw that dependence onto his heavenly Father, praying to him daily, seeking his will. Who do we rely on in life? Will we be dependent on God? I wonder. Will we be obedient? Perfect Jesus listened to and obeyed his imperfect parents. He knew and obeyed God's word and surrendered obediently to God's will for him to die on the cross to rescue us from sin and darkness. Will we obey? Even when we struggle to understand the why with what he's asking us to do. I wonder. Will we be patient? Jesus waited until he was 30 years old to start his adult ministry because that was the age at which Jewish men could become rabbis. And so Jesus wanted to kind of stick with the custom of his culture to honor that. That's a lot of years living off the beaten path in Nazareth. A lot of years in the carpenter's shop. A lot of years answering those questions at family holidays about when you're going to find a nice young lady and settle down, have some kids. A lot of ordinary time doing ordinary human things, knowing all along that he was God and had so much to offer the world. Still, he patiently waited for God's timing. Will we be patient when God asks us to hold tight, to keep faithfully plowing away at what and who is in front of us right now when our heart yearns for more? I wonder. Will we be compassionate and loving? As we talked about last week, Jesus burst onto the scene at a time in Israel where they had put up a lot of man-made rules that were meant to separate those they deemed clean and those they deemed unclean. And Jesus broke all the rules, touching the untouchables, moving towards the marginalized. He chose the overlooked and he held up the despised as examples of faith. Jesus healed humanity because his mercy always triumphs over judgment. His tender heart for the lost and broken challenges us to love those who are different, those who are annoying, and maybe even some that we would deem as enemies. But let us not forget that each one of us was born enemies of God, and our actions, thoughts, and words confirm that status. Yet he came for us. Scripture tells us, while we were a long way off, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He moved in our direction. Will we be compassionate and loving towards those who push our buttons, who we feel don't deserve it? I wonder. Will we be filled with grace and truth? That's how Jesus came. His disciple John in his gospel, chapter 1, it says that Jesus came to this world full of grace and truth. He had this amazing ability to widen the circle of grace, extending forgiveness towards those who seemed the least deserving, while also shooting them straight about their sin, speaking truth, calling them up to greater obedience. You see, most of us tend to lean one way or another on that spectrum. Most people are either kind of grace-first people or truth-first people. When we only flex one of those muscles, though, on a regular basis, it becomes unloving at its core. We end up excusing almost everything or confronting almost everything. And neither positions us with the heart of Christ. So will we be filled with grace and truth? I wonder. As we encounter Jesus this evening, my prayer throughout our sermon series has been called All the Feels. And my reasoning behind that sermon topic sign, that just kind of sounds cool, right? Is, will this information that we say we know about Jesus affect us on a heart level and move us to action? Or will it just stay something that's in our head that doesn't lead to compassionate love and grace? That the truths of Christ will connect with our hearts and draw us to worship, so that caught up in the wonder, amazed at all that Christ has done, it will lead us to action, to humility, to dependence, to obedience, to patience, to compassion, to love, to grace, and truth. I wonder if the people that we encounter each day can tell that we've been with Jesus. And in that witness, that our lives have taken on a new attractiveness, a wonder, a feeling of surprise mingled with admiration as they look at our lives, that draws people to the manger as well, to look and see for themselves. I wonder. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time to gather tonight to reflect on the wonderful story of you leaving heaven and in a shocking and really just kind of crazy, scandalous way coming to this earth to love us through a young couple who really nobody knew outside of their hometown. And God, you came in such a humble way that if people weren't really looking for you, they missed you. And only the humble and the patient and the repentant could really find you and begin a new life with you. Because following you wasn't easy, Lord. And God, I pray that as we who call ourselves followers of Christ, as we follow you, God, I pray that our life would be attractive. I pray that as people see our life, it would draw them to Christ to take a deeper look for themselves, just like those shepherds came from the hills that night to come and investigate, is this really the Christ child? God, I pray that our life would be attractive, that the aroma of Christ would be everywhere about us as we go from here tonight and this Christmas season out into the world and all the places that you've placed us, at our work, at our school, in our families. God, that Christ would just burst through us in the way that we live and the way that we love. God, I pray that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit in a way that's compelling and draws people to you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey guys, as we close tonight, it's our tradition here, as it is at a lot of churches, to close with Silent Night in the candle lighting service. And as we talked about, as we lit the candle of Christ, that Christ is the light of the world, right? He said that I am the light of the world, but he also told his followers, you are the light of the world, right? So we have a responsibility, really an opportunity to go out into the world, a dark world, and to be light. And the symbolism of what we're about to do is that as we help cast light to one another, that the light grows in here. What seems not so powerful is just one individual holding the candle becomes very powerful in the community of others who also worship Christ. That this light would emanate from Wellspring and all of their churches around the world, that the light of Christ would invade people's hearts in ways that they couldn't ignore it. So as I come and light candles and we sing this last song, if you could turn around and get the rows behind you first before you pass it down your row, get everybody ready to go with us, okay? Here we go. You guys can go ahead and stand.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child. Tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace. holy night. Shepherds quake at the sight. Glory stream from heaven afar. And heavenly hosts sing hallelujah. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. And silent night, holy night, Son of God, love. Radiant beams from thy holy face, and with the dawn of redeeming grace, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth.
Guys, thank you so much for being here with us tonight. We will be having church on Sunday morning, as usual. Enjoy your time tomorrow. On your way out, if you guys could blow those candles out and put them in the baskets as you exit. Have a wonderful Christmas holiday, and I hope to see you again. Thank you.
Tom's got to let him know. Dude, I swear, this needs...